Well, good morning again. We are on part two of a four-part series that I've entitled Life Lessons Taught by Jesus. Now, here's what's interesting. This could be called by many, it's called a couple of things. Some calls it the Beatitudes, some call it Sermon on the Mount, and here's why they call it Sermon on the Mount. We're going to jump right into it. In Matthew chapter 5, the first two verses, it says this. It says this right here. One day, as he saw the crowds gathering, and I want you to notice that. That's interesting. As Jesus saw the crowds gathering, he went up on the mountainside and sat down, and his disciples gathered around him, and he began to teach them. Now, what I want you to notice, what I want you to understand is that the crowds gathered around in this particular case, and when they gathered around, Jesus didn't go to the crowds. He went the opposite direction. Now, if you read anything in the stories about Jesus in the New Testament, you will see that typically Jesus had compassions on the crowd. He would feed the crowd. He would do miracles. But in this case, and here's what I want you to understand. This is why this is important. In this particular case, Jesus told his guys, hey, we have got to get away from the crowds. Because in order for you to be more effective to minister to the crowds, I've got to teach you how to live life. Now, he sends them back out to the crowds, but I just want you to understand, and there's a huge lesson. This is totally free. This isn't even in your outline today, all right? But here's what I want you to get. There are times, church, we got to unplug. We got to get away from the busyness of life. We got to get away from the crowds. We got to get away from everything, and we just got to sit at the master's feet. Are you with me? You just got to sit with Jesus and say, Jesus, what do you want to teach me today? If you do not do that, you will never grow in your faith in Christ. And that's our goal, all right? So anyway, that's the first thing that Jesus does. He gathers them along. And so he says, I want to teach you some things. That's what we're going to do. We're just going to learn from Jesus, the ultimate master. Yes, he saves our souls, guys. He does. And he needs to be Lord of our lives. But you know what? He also teaches us how to live life. And that's what these lessons or these beatitudes. Matter of fact, we talked about last week. You hear a lot. It depends on what translation you read in the Bible, but blessed is, and fill in the blank. And so we got to define, what does this word blessed mean? Because we throw that word around a lot, to be blessed. But we discussed last week that blessed in the Greek is a word that is described, this word anyway, is described like a joy only the gods could experience this kind of joy. If you want to be blessed, the word that they're using there is a joy that is it's not circumstantial. In other words, because we confuse the word blessed sometimes with the word happiness, all right? And a lot of times you'll be happy because, you know, maybe your team wins a Super Bowl tonight, right? Or they don't, whatever. But and if they don't, you're going to be mad. I know a few weeks ago my boys and I were not happy because the Steelers lost. And they should be the ones in the Super Bowl, all right? But, you know, our lives are so much time we're up and down because of circumstances. What Jesus is saying here, he's saying, listen to me. If you want to experience joy, something's going off there. There we go. No problem. We can sit and dance or whatever. But Jesus say, listen, if you want to experience joy, here's what I want you, a continual joy. No matter what your circumstance, I want you to live this way. And so last week, we talked about three of them. We don't have time to go through those three again. But basically, we talked about, hey, when life gets tough, you need less of yourself and more of God. Remember, if you weren't here, go check out our website. You can find that. But that just means we got to be poor in spirit. We recognize that I need to get rid of everything else. I just need God. That's most important. Secondly, you learn that in losing what's closest to you, Jesus is what matters most. And sometimes we got to lose the things in this world. And that's what we talked about. We need to repent of self-sufficiency, where I can make it on my own. We talked about mourning over sin. And then last week, thirdly, we talked about that really we got to quit being in control of our lives and totally surrender every aspect to God. That's what it means to be meek or humble, all right? That was last week. Well, this week, we looked at the first five verses last week. Now we're going to look at Matthew chapter 5, verses 6 through 12. Matthew is the first book in the New Testament. It's a biography about Jesus. So if you're not sure where Matthew is, it's easy to find there in the New Testament. You can turn there if you want, because we're going to be hanging out in Matthew today, all right? So let me give you now, let's pick up. We're going to go through the rest of these Beatitudes. Beatitude, by the way, is also, the reason we get that word, Beatitude, it comes from the word beatus, which is in the Latin, which means beatitude, and that's how we get blessed. And so that's why some people call it a beatitude. But where I like to just think of it, here are some lessons that Jesus says, this is how you need to live life, right? We good? Everybody good? All right, so hopefully you have an outline. If you like to fill in blanks, do that. We can do that. But let me give you the, this is actually the fourth one because we looked at three last week. We're going to start with number four, but it's our first one today. So here it is. Number one, when you hunger for God, that means when you desire total righteousness. Now, I'm going to explain that in just a minute. But when you desire, when you hunger for God, all of your other hunger pains will always be satisfied. All right? When you absolutely hunger for God, when you desire righteousness, every other hunger pain is going to be satisfied. All right. Now, here's the thing. I think it would be safe to say you and I probably, and there may be an exception in this room, but for the most part, I would say this, is that you and I probably don't know what it means to truly be hungry. Would most of you agree with that? Most of us don't know what it means to be at the point of starvation. I've said it before, if any of you doesn't have anything to eat tonight, you can go downtown, and there's several places downtown that will feed you, all right? Whether you're homeless or not, they don't ask any questions, just go in and they'll feed you. Most of us in America, we don't understand this, but in Palestine, it was different. There was no over, you didn't pull up to the local Golden Corral and go in and pig out, right? Matter of fact, you did not get fat on the wages that you made because actually, or the wages you didn't make because they weren't making any money. So in Palestine, maybe a working man. Last night, my family and I said, what do we want to eat? We weren't really sure. So I said, I'm going to run to the store real quick. And I went and bought a few pieces of steak, threw it on the grill, right? Because I'm a man and I love steak, man. And my whole family does too. We enjoyed that. Maybe in Palestine, you didn't just do that. You didn't hop in the car or your camel or walk down the road to Walmart and say, let me pick up some meat. Maybe once a week, a working man would eat meat. But more than likely, weekly, families were just one step away from starvation or hunger in Palestine. Are you with me? And so when you and I in America sit here and read, man, you know, just hunger for God, it's hard to fathom what it means to hunger. But these guys listened to Jesus, the disciples who were fishermen and everything they did was totally dependent on if they didn't catch any fish that day, they may go hungry, right? If they didn't work hard enough and sell whatever their trade was, they could go hungry. So I want us to understand that. We're talking about, and it's hard for us to relate to that in Mississippi. It just is. We're not talking about like, man, I'm hungry, so I need a late night snack, right? We're talking about Jesus talking about a hunger here. I want you to have a hunger that's like, Daddy, my belly hurts because I haven't eaten in days. Dad, what are we going to do for food tonight? And God, Jesus says, listen, you want to know how to fully experience joy? You want to know what it means to be blessed? Then here's what it is. You have got to want righteousness, and I'm going to define that for you in a second, but you've got to want righteousness as bad as you want your next meal. Now, what do we mean by righteousness, all right? And I'm not talking about when I say righteousness, I'm not talking about doing good deeds, although that's important. I think as Christians, good deeds don't save us. Jesus saves us, right? But once you're saved, we're called to do good deeds. But I'm not even talking about that. I'm talking about this, guys. Righteousness here that we're talking about, goodness, means that I want to live a life that pleases God more than anything else. I want to be the best husband I can be. I want to be the best wife I can be. I want to be the best child I can be to my parents. I want to be the best student I can be. I want my inner being. I want everything about me. I just want it to please God. And so as we talked about last week, in order to do that, there may be some things we got to get rid of, right? And Jesus is just saying, he's just saying, listen, I want you to understand this. Until you get to that point where you hunger for me more than anything else, even you got to hunger, Jesus says, hunger for me almost more than your next meal. Because until you get to that point, you will not know what total righteousness is. Does that make sense? And so it's not just about being good, although that's a byproduct of it. But guys, we got a desire. We got a hunger for God. I want more of you in my life. God, I want to be like you. And I know, God, we fall short of that, and I've fallen short of that. But God, today, make me, I want you as much as I wanted that steak I went to Walmart and got last night, right? that's what it means to be satisfied. When you do that, then you'll realize the other things in your life do not matter as much. They just don't. They don't matter as much. So that's the first thing, all right? Jesus says, you want to be blessed, you want to know what it means to be content, then you got a hunger and you got a thirst for righteousness. Then I'm going to fill you up, man. You're going to know true contentment. Here's the second thing that he goes into. Here's the second lesson or beatitude that Jesus teaches as he's up on this mountainside with his disciples. And by the way, I said last week, I think it's more than just mountainside. That was one particular incident, but I think these are lessons that Jesus taught his disciples continually. Here's the second one, though. And I'm going to word it this way, and then I'll give you the beatitude. Spend your life putting others before yourself, and then God will care for you. Now, right there, that is a beatitude or a lesson that is hard for us to swallow. Because let's just be honest, since we come out of the womb, we're a self-centered people, right? We come out of the womb needing someone to take care of us. We come out of the womb hungry. We come out of the womb needing somebody to change our diaper. And as we grow up, the world centers around us. Let's just be real about that. And Jesus comes along and says, guys, as I got your attention, I want to teach you something totally different. And he uses a word here that's very interesting. And he says this, here's the beatitude, or here's the next one, scripture, Matthew 5:7. God blesses those, again, God gives joy, he gives that contentment to those who are merciful, for they are going to be shown mercy. So let's talk about that for just a second. What does mercy mean? Or maybe another word we could tie in with this mercy is forgiveness. What does forgiveness and mercy mean? Because I tell you what, those are two difficult virtues to grasp. When someone has wronged you, when someone has hurt you, it is hard to be forgiving in our flesh. It is. It is hard to experience mercy. Actually, in Matthew 18, Jesus said this. He goes, look, if you don't forgive others, God in heaven is not going to forgive you. That's a pretty bold statement. I think I've got this verse on the screen. James 2:13 says this. There will be mercy for those who have, there will not be no mercy for those who have not shown mercy to others. But if you have been merciful, God will be merciful when he judges you. Now, let me explain this. The Greek word here for mercy is a word called eleemon. But as I told you guys last week, if you weren't here, Jesus didn't, when he spoke, he didn't speak in Greek. He spoke in what's called Aramaic. It's a form of Hebrew. And the Hebrew word here for mercy is a word that's called hesed. Now, hesed is almost impossible to translate in the English language. I remember I had an Old Testament professor that would talk about this, and he would almost get emotional. There is no way you and I can really define what hesed is. But if we're going to try, here's the best way to describe this beatitude. All right? Are you guys freezing? A lot of people seem like they're freezing. Some are not. So maybe bump it up just a little bit. No, some aren't. All right. Just maybe a hair. Anyway, here's what hesed means. Hesed literally means this in the Hebrew. It's to get in the skin of somebody else. In other words, if I want to know what you're going through, the only way I can experience what you go through is to be in your shoes. It's to get under your skin. Only way I can experience that is to feel what you feel, to think what you think, to know what you think, is to get in your skin. So let me ask you a question, all right? And I know what the answer is. It's a rhetorical question, but I'm going to ask it anyway. How many of you have ever been wounded by somebody's blows, by somebody's actions, by somebody's words, whether they're a friend or not? Well, maybe it's an enemy. Anybody in here ever happened to? Yeah, every single one of us can raise our hand. And what is our typical response to that? Our typical response is anger, right? Our typical response is to lash out or to be defensive or to get back. That's human nature. I mean, that's what we do. There's no question about that. But, you know, that's just kind of our way of life. But Jesus says, wait a minute. Before you do that, because listen, you will not go through this world and not be wrong. You will not go through this world and somebody not hurt you. You're not going to go through this world and somebody not hit you with a blow or words of anger. Something just stings, right? Jesus says, what if you did this? What if you just kind of step back and say, all right, let me just think, what is that person going through right now? What if I just kind of got into their skin? What if I began to treat them the way I want to be treated? I had a wise person tell me one time, you know, it said to me, you know, Tim, hurting people hurt others. Typically, when someone's wounding you or hurting you, it's because they're hurting. It's because they're wounded. And maybe if we just step back and say, you know, I wonder what's different here. I wonder, what is this person going through? What are they experiencing? What has happened in their life that causes them to treat me this way? And it's a whole, and you know, most of the disciples are sitting there going, dude, this is messed up. I want to go back to the Old Testament, an eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, right? What's this turn the other cheek stuff? Jesus saying, I know, but listen, that is not how the Heavenly Father sees you. That's not how I see you. And believe me, if anybody, and we'll get to that in just a minute, if anybody understands blows and being wounded, it's Jesus, right? And Jesus says, matter of fact, think about this. There is no greater example of getting into the flesh or skin of somebody than Jesus, right? Jesus, in the Christian world, this is what we believe wholeheartedly, that God exists as three persons. He's one God. He exists as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, all right? And so there's a point where Jesus, he was always there. Jesus was never born. Jesus was always was. He's always been a part of that Trinity. He's eternal. But there was a point where he became incarnate. He literally put on human flesh. Talk about getting under the skin of somebody. Suddenly, God now can see things the way you and I see things. God can feel the way you and I feel. Does that make sense? Let me tell you what. I have studied other religions, all kinds of them. I know about them. I've read them. No other religion in the world teaches what Christianity teaches. That God is so crazy about you that he says, I want to be where you are. I want to feel what you feel. I want to know what you feel. So I'm going to send myself to you. Does that make sense? That's what it means to have mercy. That's what it means to have this hesed. Maybe an example is this. Queen Victoria was a very close friend of a principal and his wife, Mrs. Tulloch, of St. Andrews. Well, the queen's husband, Prince Albert, had died, and Queen Victoria was left all alone. And about the same time, well, Principal Tulloch died as well, and so his wife, Mrs. Tulloch, was left all alone. And one day, the queen decided to go and visit Miss Tulloch totally unannounced. She wasn't going to announce her presence. And Miss Tulloch was just resting on the couch. And when she finally came in the room and they announced that the queen was here, quickly, Mrs. Tulloch tried to get up to curtsy. She had to pay her respects. Because when the queen walks in the room, you stand and then you bow, right? That's what you do. But very quickly, the queen stopped her and said, no, don't get up. I'm not coming to you as a queen today, but I'm coming to you as one friend to another who has lost a spouse. You know what? I think that's exactly what Jesus is saying to us. That's what God did for us. He is coming. He came giving up his divine privileges, Paul tells us in Philippians, so that he can relate to you and me. Does that make sense? That's what Jesus did. That's what Hesed did. And so it is only those who show this kind of mercy who are going to be shown this kind of mercy. Are you with me? Can we just remind you, this is just reality. Every single one of us will stand before God one day. Every person who has ever lived. Some of us will stand before God with Jesus as our lawyer, so to speak, right? He'll say, hey, God, guess what? I got this one covered. He showed mercy. I've shown mercy. But there will be others who will stand before God who don't have his covering because they were not merciful. They never accepted his forgiveness and never experienced repentance, all right? William Barclay said, for it is the great truth of life that in other people we see the reflection of ourselves. Think about that. Well, that's a pretty powerful statement, all right? If we are too detached, if we're too distant, if we're too distracted, if we're too disinterested, then guess what? They're going to be disinterested in us. That person does not care about me. But if we are people of love and we're a people of grace and we're a people of hesed, of mercy, then guess what? That will be given back to us. Isn't that an awesome thought? This is not the same thing as karma or anything like that. This is just a principle in life. But one day we'll stand before God, and he will judge us based on whether we've received mercy or given mercy. All right, here's the third thing then. So that's the next lesson that Jesus taught. Then he moves into another one here, third one for us today. And that's this. I want you to write this down. So how do I do all this? How do I become this person? How do I experience this joy? Well, number three, I want you to write this. You change your life by changing your heart. You change your life by changing your heart. And here's what Jesus said, Matthew 5:8. God blesses those, again, God gives that continuous joy to those who are pure, for they will see God. Now, I don't know about you, but when I read this one, this just really should have each of us kind of pause and ask some questions to ponder. right? But first of all, how in the world is it even possible to be pure? Well, what does it mean to be pure in heart? Can any of us in this room be pure in heart? I mean, that almost seems like an impossibility. Well, again, if you guys will give me just a few seconds here, you got to understand the language in which it was written in. There is a Greek word here for pure of heart. It's this. It's katharos. And it has a couple of different meanings, but the word that it really meant the most was to take something that was dirty and clean it. All right? So it really, if it would be no other if one Jew said to another Jew, hey, here, I want you to take these clothes and katharos them. You can clean them. All right? They're dirty. They're filthy. They just need to be clean. All right? But here's what's interesting. In the Greek, they would take another word, an adjective, and put before that. And that adjective was erikatos. And what that word meant was it referred to milk or wine that was totally undiluted. You didn't add any water to it. So it was pure. Does that make sense? Especially back in those days, especially as I talked about earlier, you didn't have any money. Let me tell you what, if you had any wine or milk in the house, you were going to water that puppy down because you had it stretch out. But Jesus is saying here, here's what I want you to have. Your heart has to be unmixed. Don't say you love me and you love the things of the world too, because they don't go together. What I need from you, Jesus is saying, I need you to be totally unadulterated. I need 100% of an unmixed love. Does that make sense? That's the word he's using there, all right? Let me give you an example. Maybe and put it in terms here. Let's say that we love to, we're givers financially. There's a charity we love. Maybe there's it's your church. Maybe it's your pastor and you want to give to me, which certainly you're more than welcome to do. I'll accept that. Whatever it is, that charity, you're giving to that charity, right? But let's just be honest. Maybe deep down inside, there's still a desire for others to notice, man, did you see how much that guy gives? That's pretty awesome, you know? And deep down inside, you're like, yeah, I know. Man, I'm just, that's just me at heart. I'm just a giver, that's who I am. And there's a satisfaction you get from knowing that you're the greatest donator. You have given the greatest donation. Does that make sense? But if our motives are unmixed, then we don't want to receive some type of self-satisfaction. Matter of fact, if our motives are unmixed, we just kind of anonymously give that donation and walk away. Does that make sense? But our human nature, it's difficult to do that because that's not our nature. So I would say, for me, more than any of these lessons that Jesus has taught us here, this is the one that kind of just stops and begs us to examine our lives. I want you to do that for just a second. Maybe somewhere in your outline you want to write these questions down or just commit them to memory. But ask yourself some tough questions. What is my motive in life? What is my motive? Seriously. Is my work done from motives of service or from motives of pay? Obviously, those of you who have a job, you're working to get money to provide for your family. But I'm talking about, in just life in general. Or as you're serving the church, you're serving Jesus. You know, is your service given from selfish motives, or are they from motives of self-display? Look at what I can do. Is the work we do in the church for Christ, or is it for our own self-prestige? And guys, like I said before, it can be a very difficult thing to examine ourselves, because there are a few things in this world that we can do without, that we can do without just truly, having a selfish nature. It's about me. But Jesus goes on to say one other thing with this passage. He says, you know what? It's only those who are pure in heart that are really going to see God. And you know what I think that means? That means you're going to see what you want to see. Are you with me? You're going to see what you want to see. Kind of an example, I guess. I just don't have time to exercise, right? But you have time to watch, six episodes in one day of Netflix, your favorite season, right? You make time for what you want to do. Jesus says it's only with those with a pure heart that are going to really truly see God. I read one illustration. It's like this. For me, example, if I went outside on, say, it's a beautiful, clear night, I can look, and I look up in the stars, and I can go, yeah, that's pretty cool. I see a few pinpoints of light there. Okay, I get that. But standing right next to me is an astronomer who has studied the stars, and he begins to name this one and this constellation and this, this galaxy and these things, and he's just overwhelmed because he understands it. He's getting out of it what he's put into it because his heart is pure. Does that make sense? He's tuned to look for that. And guys, I'll just be real. Let me just be real and honest for a moment. A lot of us do not see God because our hearts are not pure. We don't see God. We don't see God because we're getting out of it what we're putting into it. Does that make sense? And there comes a point where we just say, God, here's what we've done. If I had a pie chart here, I'm going to give you this part, this part, this part, this part of my life. This little slice I'm keeping for me. It's not yours. All right? God says, man, you got to trust me with this. If you don't give over even that little slice, it's going to affect the rest of your life. And you've got to turn over everything. It's only those who are pure with an unmixed motive that are going to truly see God one day. Does that make sense? I hope so. So that's what Jesus is teaching us. All right, I've got two more here, and we'll be done. But let's look at the next one, all right, the fourth one for us. God is looking for those who will build and maintain good relationships with people of every background. God is looking for those who will build and maintain good relationships with people of every background. I think right now, guys, This one right here may be one of those most pertinent and relevant lessons Jesus teaches to us because of the nature of our country right now and the world we live in. Look at what he says. Here's the actual verse in the New Living Translation. God blesses those who work. I want you to get that, who work for peace. That's the key in this phrase right here. Those who work for peace. Not believe in peace, but those who work for peace. For they will be called children of God. Does that make sense? Let me try to explain this. Now, again, Jesus is speaking to Jews, and he's speaking in an Aramaic. He's speaking in a Hebrew dialect. And probably the word that Jesus uses for peace is what? What do you guys know? What's the Hebrew word for peace? Shalom. That's exactly right. Now, shalom means this. Shalom does not mean I just wish you the absence of something evil. Shalom means I wish for you that everything in your life is good. Everything. Now, it's not just I hope that something bad doesn't happen to you today. No, it's everything about your life, there is a goodness there. Wouldn't that be a great thing? I would definitely want that kind of life. God, don't just take the presence of evil away, but everything I touch, everything I do, it blesses you and it's good. Right? And that's what Jesus is meaning here. If a Jew says to another Jew, shalom, he is wishing him the presence of all good things. All right? So in the Bible, shalom or peace means more than just freedom from trouble. It means the enjoyment of all that is good. Now I want you to get that. All right? So what Jesus is really teaching here is this. I want you to be peacemakers, not peace lovers. Are you with me? Because every one of us in this room, is there anyone in here who would not say, hey, I love peace? I mean, you know, if you would say that, you've probably got a little issue there, and meet with me later and we'll talk about that, all right? No, most of us in the room are going to go, dude, I want peace, I love it. But let me tell you what, there is a whole world of difference between saying, hey, I want peace, and saying, I'm going to do everything I can to bring peace to our relationship. And nothing tears a church apart faster. Nothing tears apart marriages faster. Nothing tears apart communities faster than when a people are divided. And Jesus says, let me tell you what, if you want to truly know what it means to be blessed, if you want to truly know contentment, I am begging you, be in good relationships with everybody that you're in a relationship with. Guys, we have got to be men and women of peace. Matter of fact, I think maybe it would be better worded, you know, blessed are the peacemakers for they're doing godlike work. Because let me tell you what, when God sent Jesus, what did he send him for? See, here's the gospel, here's the story of Christianity in a message, or in a phrase. You and I are messed up because of sin. The Bible just calls it sin. And because of that sin, because of the bad stuff we do, and we're born that way, that separates us from a holy God. We are not at peace with God. We are at odds with God because of our sin. And so God said, I tell you what, I can't stand that because I created you in my image. I love you. I'm wild about you, so I'm going to send myself. I'm going to send my son. And my son, Jesus, is going to be the ultimate peacemaker. And now, church, you and I have got to do the same thing. We have got to be peacemakers. Not just lovers of peace, but peacemakers. Matter of fact, I think this beatitude, it suggests three things. These aren't in your outline. Let me just give them to you real quick. The first one, that, in other words, here's what people have read this, they've interpreted it. And the first one, they've kind of said, all right, I think this beatitude means the man who makes the world a better place to live. That's good, but that also sounds like something Miss America would get up and say, right? You know, just pray for world peace. That's what I really wish for. Yeah, that's good, and we want that. But I don't think that's really what Jesus is saying here. Another one, often scholars have said that this beatitude or this lesson really means something spiritual. That it's just really, you know, blessed is the man who makes peace in his own heart and soul. Like, you know, it's almost like we got those, Hollywood is so great, they won't use theology, but they'll say you got a devil on this shoulder, an angel on this shoulder, and they're kind of, you know, shoulder, and they're telling you something. Well, that's not true theology, but there is an inner conflict within us. You know, John 10:10 says the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, and Jesus says, I come to give life. We're at war, right? But, so, yeah, that's true. And so, you know, and so I think some scholars are saying, blessed is the man who finds that inner peace. And I'm all for that, because you find that inner peace, then yeah, you're going to be a peaceful person. But here's the third one. I think this really is what Jesus had in mind. I think here's the most accurate. Jesus would say, blessed is the man who can establish right relationships with his fellow man. Are you with me? Blessed is the person who can say, I want to be at total shalom with you, and you, and you, and you. And let me tell you what, I said, I think this is the most relevant. Because we're expected to get along with one another. We're expected to love one another, and we don't see that happening. I don't know if you know this or not. Some of you do. I'm on the Hinds County School Board. And if you have watched the news at all or been on Facebook at all, you have seen that the high school where my oldest son graduated from, my middle son right now attends, and my two youngest kids are going to go to one day, was dubbed the school from hell this week. A few weeks ago, a fight broke out on another campus, but with our students, and then that kind of was carried over, and another fight broke out at our campus, and then we've had two fistfights that have made national news. I mean, national news. Our superintendent was on national news with this lady talking about the problems at Terry High School. And so they asked me as a board member to come. We had a press conference the other day at Terry High School, and three news media stations showed up, and the principal was going to get up and give a statement. But before he got up, before the news media came in, I said, let me tell you guys something. I just kind of stood up and said, I just want to say something real quick before the news media comes in. I said, I know I was elected as a public official to be on this school board, but I want you to know I'm not coming this morning as a school board member. Really, I'm coming as a parent more than anything. But ultimately, I said, here's what I want you to understand. Whether you like this or you want to hear this or not, I said, I'm also coming as a pastor, but more importantly, as a follower of Jesus. And I'm here to tell you today, guys, we can set all the rules, all the regulations we want, but this is a spiritual battle. That's what I told them before the news media got there. In fact, when the news media got there, they asked me to give the presentation first. I spoke, and not one news media showed one clip of what I said. All right? And they didn't want to hear, you know, they didn't want to hear that. But anyway, but what I told those guys, and I told our superintendent of the Hinds County School District, you know, I said, and this is a public school, but I'm telling you, our kids, one, parents got to get their butts in gear and teach their kids how to act, all right, and discipline their kids. But number two, we are at war spiritually speaking. And when I watch this video of these kids just beating the crap out of each other, I don't even know if you're allowed to say that in church, but I just did. That's what they're doing. It breaks my heart. And there is an absence, yes, of shalom. And we've got to get our teenagers and our children to understand at a young age that what God desires. And he desires for you to be at peace with your fellow man. Amen? That's why Jesus came. Amen. That's why he came. And we need to live that. So listen to me. Don't just say you love peace. Here's the question. Here's your homework assignment. What are you going to do this week to be a peacemaker? What are you and I, what are we going to do to say, I'm going to do my part to bring shalom to this world? All right? Think about that. Let me give you the last one, then we'll be done here. Write this down, number five. When a man has to suffer, and I mean suffer, and I'm going to give you some examples of suffering here in just a moment. When a man has to suffer for his faith, that is the closest possible companionship with Christ that one can get. when a man suffers because of his faith for some reason, whatever that is, that's the possible closest companionship you could ever get with Jesus. Let me explain. All right, let's tell you what. Let's look at verses 10 through 11 here. God blesses those who are persecuted for doing right, for the kingdom of heaven is there. God blesses those people who mock you and who persecute you and who lie about you and all sorts of evil things are said against you because you are my followers. And I'll come back to that last part in just a second here. But listen to me for just a second here. Jesus Christ knew what it meant to suffer, right? I mean, that guy was beaten. And not only was he beaten, but he was crucified and he was totally sinless. He was totally perfect, all right? Let me ask you this question. Again, it's a rhetorical question and I know the answer to it, but I'm just going to say it. How many of you have been lied about to somebody else? How many of you maybe have been gossiped about or blamed for something that you know you didn't do because maybe somebody has it out for you? And you have felt that type of persecution. Yeah, most of us can raise our hands to that. It's not unpleasant. It hurts, right? It hurts when that happens to us. But let's be honest. Let's be honest, though. And I'm not minimizing that at all. But you know what? None of us here, I think, really, in this room, know what it means to be persecuted for Jesus. Amen. The early church did. Did you realize that in the first century there, after Christ had been crucified and resurrected, and now he's at the Father, and we get like the book of Acts, and now, boom, the church is starting to grow, and people are saying they're following Jesus. Do you realize that by knowing Christ and by refusing to worship the other deities that were around you, by saying, no, I believe there's only one God, not multiple gods, did you realize that you lost your jobs, you lost your social life, and you lost your home life? Now, that's bad enough, but let me just tell you, this is not pleasant. But let me just tell you some things that happened in the first century as a result of being a Christian. For example, Christians were flung to the lions and they were burned at the stake just for claiming Jesus. And that was the easy stuff. I mean, as a matter of fact, I can't imagine being burned alive, can you? You either recant, say you don't love this Jesus, or you will be burned at the stake. But those were kind deaths. Nero, who was an emperor at the time, he wrapped Christians in pitch, he would set them on fire, and he literally used them as living torches to light his gardens. He would have these huge parties and invite his non-Christian friends over. He would take Christian human beings, wrap them in pitch, and catch them on fire and put them up on a torch so it would light his gardens. And he would take his party through and say, look at my gardens. And the illumination he used would be burning Christians. The guy was sick and twisted. He did more than that. He would sew Christians up in skins of wild animals. And then he would set his wild dogs on them to eat them alive. They were tortured on the rack. Molten lead was poured hissing upon them. Red-hot brass plates were affixed to their tenderest parts of their bodies. Eyes were ripped out. Parts of their bodies were torn off and roasted. They would literally cut off part of their body and then roast it before their eyes. Their hands and feet were burned, and then cold water was poured over them to lengthen the agony. Again, I'm not trying to do shock effect here. This is not fun to talk about. I want you to understand, this is what has happened. One day we will meet those brothers and sisters of Christ who've experienced that. That is what our brother, whether it was 2,000 years ago or not, doesn't matter. That's what people who love Jesus have experienced. Now, let me ask you this question. Do you love Jesus that much? I mean, seriously, if that happened today, and we got to be real, it's so hard to wrap your mind around that because you know that's not going to happen today, right? What we're going to do is go home and eat a lot of food and watch the Super Bowl. That's what some of you don't care about that, but I'm just saying, as a culture, that's what we're going to do today. And we're not going to give another thought of what it means to be persecuted for Jesus. But I just want to ask you this question. Are you persecuted? If it came to that point, would you love Jesus enough to die for him in that way? You know, when a man is called to suffer something for his Christianity, you know what? That's a crucial moment. That is a crucial moment. And it's also a blessed occasion. What, you mean being burned on a stake is a blessed occasion? Well, it is according to this. This is good news for all those who've suffered, for those who have laid down their life for Jesus for the last 2,000 years, who've offended, who have defended God to the point of death, because Jesus says, listen, be glad. That last part there, he says, be happy about it. Be happy that you've been burned to the stake. Be happy that you've been torn apart by the lions. Be very glad, because guess what? I know right now life is hard. Life is difficult. I mean, I know right now that is painful, but guess what? Something incredible is going. How many of you are so thankful that right now is not all that there is? And maybe you believe that. And if you do, man, I come talk to me, because I want you to know there's something far greater than what you're experiencing now. But listen, Jesus is teaching this so you can be content right now. But one day, man, there is going to be an incredible award. Matter of fact, you're in great company, because you're also included in with the prophets who thousands of years ago were beaten and killed because they believed in Jesus. And so I think what Jesus is saying, listen, if somehow, don't worry, be happy, because an awesome reward awaits you one day. You know? And then I have that, what was his name, Bobby McPherson, that song, Don't Worry, Be Happy, that popped in my head. But anyway, I don't think that's probably what we want to sing as we're being tortured, but let me just say this real quick. In Matthew chapter 11, you don't have to turn there, but in Matthew 11, John the Baptist was in prison. All right? He's in prison. And now, earlier, before we get to that point, you got to remember, John the Baptist saw Jesus, and he goes, there he is. There's the Lamb of the world, the one who takes away the sins of the world. And John the Baptist baptized Jesus. So he's already acknowledged him as the Savior. He's acknowledged him as the Messiah. But then the circumstances for John the Baptist change. And now John the Baptist is in prison, right? And he sends his guy, because he can't leave, but he sends his guys over and says, you know, I'm a little confused. I thought maybe I got the guy wrong. Something's going on. There's some doubt or something. And he says, are you the Messiah? And this is what Jesus does. Jesus says, go back to John and answer him this way. Go back to him and say, listen, everything is done according to plan. The kingdom is being inaugurated. The kingdom is being set up. And tell him, tell John, guess what? This is a kingdom that is worth being imprisoned for. John, you're in a good spot. But I'm in jail. I know, but you're in a good spot. Let me just give you three things real quick, and we're going to be done, as to why the kingdom of God is worth being persecuted for. Here's the first thing. Because you know what? It's a kingdom where the rejected are received. He said to this, he goes, tell John that the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cured, and the deaf hear. Guys, in our society, even today, still, the second-rate people are thrown to the curb. I mean, a few weeks ago, I did a message on the sanctity of life. We're killing babies in the womb, but also, we're taking that a step further. Old people, as they get old, we don't want to have to care for them. There are some cultures now that are just killing them off. You know what? Second are people that are children that are born with a disease or a mental retardation or whatever. You know, doctors are saying, hey, just abort them, just kill them. You know what? He's saying to John, listen, guess what? Those who are poor in spirit, those that society has rejected, you, me, guess what? This is great news. It's worth being persecuted over, because you were being received. Maybe you didn't make the social club at school. Maybe you weren't in a popular group. Let me tell you what, there's not a greater group you could ever be included in the kingdom of God. And those who are being rejected are now being received, John. Second reason, let me tell you why it's so great that you're in prison for the kingdom of God is this. Because it's a kingdom where the dead have life. Let me tell you what, studies have shown that the death rate is right around 100% for all of us. Right? Nobody has beaten that yet. Every one of you will die. But when you know Jesus, and when you're persecuted for this kingdom, in this kingdom, he said that. John, tell John that the dead are raised to life. Wow, what an amazing concept. I physically will die one day. But this body and then what I really am, my soul, my inner being, that will be resurrected also to new life. Isn't that awesome? And then he says this. Tell John that this is also a kingdom for the poor in spirit. We talked about that last week. And again, if you haven't had a chance to hear that, go to our website, check it out. But this is a kingdom. I love this, guys. This is a kingdom where membership is granted. It's not earned. There is nothing you can do to get into this kingdom except accept is just accept what Jesus has to offer. And he said, tell them, hey, the good news is being preached to the poor, to the people that the society has cast off. Does that make sense? And so, guys, this is what I just say to you this morning. The good news is we don't have to wait till we die to experience the kingdom of heaven. Isn't that awesome? We can experience it now. It's not likely, like I said, that any of us in this room, that death awaits us today because of our faith in Jesus, right? Probably more than likely that's not going to happen. But I'll say this, for some of us, and you may have experienced this, insults may come because, you know, come to those who insist on Christian honor and values. Oh, you mean, come on, it's not, you know, who cares? It's, you know, I don't know, maybe it's, you know, you're hanging out with a group of guys, man, and it's like, you know, they check out this girl going by and you're a married man. Oh, come on, don't worry about that. No, guys, I'm not. I'm going to keep my eyes on Jesus. I'm going to keep my eyes on my wife. And you may begin to get some insults because of that. I don't know. Maybe mockery awaits for those who love and forgive others who've grossly wronged them. You mean you're telling me that guy or that girl did this to you and you're willing to forgive them? What a stupid principle. I don't care what your Bible says. That's a form of persecution, right? Maybe you might lose your job because you refuse to submit to dishonest work. I'm not going to give in to, you know, just fudge a little bit on the figures. No, I'm not going to do it, you know, because Jesus says to be a man or woman of integrity and honesty, all right? The truth is, and listen to me on this morning, Christ still needs witnesses. He still needs witnesses. He needs those who are, yes, prepared to die for him, but also those who are prepared to live for him. And guys, that's what these Beatitudes sum up. That's what they sum up. Jesus needs you to be willing to die for him. And all of us will, like I said, one day die. But are you willing right now in this moment to live for Jesus? If you died today, what would be said about you? What would be your legacy? It's a tough question to, you know, to ponder. If I died this moment, and your family had to call up Pastor Tim and say, man, you know, so-and-so died, we got to plan a funeral. What would I or your other family members say about you? What would they say about me? I promise. And the preacher always says, and I'm going to end with this one. All right, and then 10 minutes later, he's still saying, I'm going to end with this one. I'm going to end with this one, I promise. Max Lucado wrote an awesome book called The Applause of Heaven. And there's a little story. Let me read the story, and then we'll pray. He says, the year was 1899, and it marked the death of two well-known men. One of them was a man by the name of Dwight L. Moody, who was an acclaimed evangelist, and the other one was Robert Ingersoll, a famous lawyer, orator, and political leader. Both of these guys died in 1899. The two men had many similarities. Both were raised in Christian homes. Both were skilled orators. Both traveled extensively and were widely respected. Both drew immense crowds when they spoke and attracted loyal followings. But there was one striking difference between them. It was their view of God. Ingersoll was an agnostic and a follower of naturalism. He had no belief in the eternal, but stressed the importance of living only in the here and now. He made light of the Bible, stating that free thought is what will give us truth. To him, the Bible was a fable, an obscenity, a humbug, a sham, and a lie. Those were actual quotes by him. He was a bold spokesman against the Christian faith, and he claimed that a Christian creed was the ignorant past bullying the enlightened present. Ingersoll's contemporary, however, was Dwight L. Moody. And he had much different convictions. He dedicated his life to presenting a resurrected king to a dying people. He embraced the Bible as the hope for humanity and the cross as the turning point for history. He left behind a legacy of written and spoken words, institutions of education, churches, and changed lives. Two men, both powerful speakers and influential leaders, one rejected God, the other embraced him. And the impact of their decisions is most seen clearly on the way they died. One biographer wrote it this way. Ingersoll died suddenly. The news of his death stunned his family. His body was kept at home for several days because his wife was reluctant to part with it. Eventually, it was removed for the sake of the family's health. Ingersoll's remains were cremated, and the public response to his passing was altogether dismal. For a man who put all of his hopes on this world, death was tragic, and it came without any consolation of hope. Moody's legacy, however, quite different. On December 22nd in 1899, Moody awoke to his last winter dawn. Having grown increasingly weak during the night, he began to speak in slow, measured words. "Earth recedes, heaven opens before me." His son Will, who was nearby, hurried across the room to his father's side. "Father, are you dreaming?" he said. "No, this is no dream, Will. It is beautiful. It's like a trance. If this is death, it is sweet. God is calling me and I must go. Do not call me back." At that point, the family gathered around, and moments later, the great evangelist died. And it was on his coronation day, a day that he looked forward to for many years, he was with the Lord. The funeral service of Dwight L. Moody reflected that same confidence. There was no despair. Loved ones gathered to sing praise to God at a triumphant home-going service. Many remembered the words of the evangelist had spoken earlier that year in New York City. He said, "Someday you will read in the papers that Moody is dead. Don't you believe a word of that. At that moment, I shall be more alive than I am now. I was born of the flesh in 1837. I was born of the spirit in 1855. And that which is born of the flesh will die, but that which is born of the spirit will live forever." And so Jesus says to John, or to John's followers, his disciples, go back and tell him, "John, your worldly struggles, they're temporary. I know it stinks to be imprisoned. I know the financial struggles, NBC, that you're going through, or the relationship struggles you're going through. But let me tell you what, if you will do these things that I pulled my disciples along on the side of the mountain and said, hey, do, you will find a joy. You will find a peace, a shalom that you've never known before." And so, guys, that's what I say to you today. I want to ask you if you just bow your heads and close your eyes.